Bueno, no sé si me oís ahora, si hablo, claro, no me oías porque no estaba diciendo nada. Lo siento, espero que podamos utilizar los minutos que me faltan. Creo que la charla tiene que ser en inglés y así lo voy a hacer. Voy a hablar en inglés y espero que haya alguien que me estéis escuchando. So we want to be talking today about basic and applied research in biomedicine, two sides of the same coin. And basically, this is to say that both basic and applied are important. Talking about the different types of research, for instance, you have here some bacteria. You might wish to investigate the mechanism they use to defend from viruses, or then you can have some research regarding how to develop, let's say, new drugs for treating diabetes. The first one is basic and the second one is applied. Question is whether you would like to invest your money, your tax money, in basic as well as applied. And this is both important. And it's important for what I'm going to be telling you in the next minutes, which is related to the CRISPR. And of course, the important is to realize, not now, because we know CRISPR is a success, is a blockbuster. Important is to know what happens with CRISPR before 2012. So CRISPR, so the genome editing tool, is everywhere. And it's thanks to this person, this microbiology, Francisco Juan Martinez Mojica from the University of Alicante, who started investigating the microorganisms living in the saltworks of Santa Pola in Alicante. So there is a list of values that I wish to convey over this seminar. And the first of these values is curiosity. So Francis had the curiosity to understand what was this macroorganism that was living in these saltworks, Allopherax mediterranei and archaea. And then he came across a very peculiar organization of the genome with some repeated sequences. And as here is illustrated in this figure, which were separating all the sequences that were unique. This organization was not the first time that had been seen. So previously, Japanese in the 87 had seen this in bacteria, in gram negatives, and some Dutch microbiologists in 91, they have seen similar things in bacteria gram positive. So the second value I wish to convey, it's not only curiosity, but serendipity. So you need to take into account that there are some things that are relevant. And it is relevant to realize that the gram negatives, the proteobacteria, and the gram positives, and the allophils, which are the archaea they were investigating, if you follow this evolutionary tree, you will see that they only coincide at the beginning of life. So we are having three different organisms that they share the same structure of the genome, and they seem to have inherited this from their ancestors, and the ancestors, they need to be shared, which means the origin of life. So this is relevant. So this is the serendipity part of this research, which means that we realize that this is something relevant to be investigated. The next thing that will happen is that you need to pay attention to the relevant information. For many years, people were paying attention to the repeated sequences, and even in 2002, Francis named these sequences cluster regularly interspaced short palindromic repeats, CRISPR, which is a word which has been famous and it's in the mouth of everyone. But you need to be perseverant, because if you are perseverant, you will realize that perhaps the relevant information is not in the repeated sequences, but what lies in between. And what lies in between are pieces of the genomes of the different viruses that are infecting these bacteria. And when this happens, this bacteria becomes resistant to this infection. So as a matter of fact, in 2003, and eventually he published this in 2005, Francis Mojica discovered that CRISPR, due to this curiosity, serendipity, and perseverance, was immune system, an adaptive immune system by which the bacteria was capturing fragments of these viral genomes, and that was the mechanism that was entitling this bacteria to defend from this bacteria, from these viruses. This is the paper he published in 2005, and eventually the mechanism was worked out and it was transferred to eukaryotes, and this is what we have today as genome editing. Next value I want to highlight is collaboration, because nothing that has happened today in the CRISPR world could have happened without the participation of a number of different scientists. Here there are 12 different researchers from the very beginning, Francis, but also other microbiologists. And in the center, we have three persons, Emmanuel Charpentier, Jennifer Doudna, and Virginio Signis. These were the ones that in 2012 realized that this immune system could be converted into a genome editing tool. And that was confirmed by the four people in the bottom, which are geneticists, Feng Zhang, George Church, Rudy Jenish, and Keith Young, were the ones that confirmed that this was happening. This is how the CRISPR-Cas system was described in 2012, a nuclease, this yellow thing, this Cas9 normally, that is guided to cut a double-strand break somewhere because of a single guide RNA. And this is what is occurring today in 2020. So it's pretty much the same. The difference is that the guide has been returned to the original two compounds, a CRISPR RNA that contains these 20 ribonucleotides that target the whole complex to a given sequence, and the tracer RNA that interacts with the first and links to the nuclease. This is, of course, something that is not only happening with CRISPR, but is also happening with other nucleases that have been described before, like TALEN, zinc finger nucleases, omega nucleases. And basically what they do, all these tools, is cutting DNA. Cutting DNA at a given place, at the double-strand break, next to a signal, which is the protospacer adjacent motif, or PAM. And this is triggering a repair system. The full repair system is the left pathway, which is non-homologous enjoining, that is running by adding and removing nucleotides. And these indels eventually will restitute the physical continuity of the chromosome, but normally will lead to the gene disruption. And the right pathway is the repairing-driven biomology, in which you can give a template that is homologous at either side of the double-strand break and can introduce some de novo sequence. And this is the properly known gene edition. And of course, as you know, gene edition is applied in many different ways and in many different applications, going very rapidly. If you use one of these CRISPR cuts, you will be disrupting a gene by simply just promoting this cut, and the reparation will disrupt the gene. If you combine two, you can promote a deletion, and at the same time, you can promote an inversion, auto-application, or any chromosomal rearrangement. You can do point mutations because you can cut in a given place in the gene, and you can provide a template carrying a given mutation, hoping that this will be used for reconstitute the locus. You can even insert big pieces. So the next value I want to highlight, going very rapidly, is choosing the right method. Because sometimes you are stuck and we are frozen in a given research project because we are not using the correct method. And this is what had happened for us investigating a rare disease, a human rare disease, which is albinism, that we investigate using experimental laboratory animals with mice. Albinism, which is associated to a number of genes that impact on pigmentation, but also in the visual capacity. For many years, we've been investigating the role of different regulatory elements, such as these red balls or these purple balls. But how can we assess the role of these elements? For many years, we tried to do direct homologous recombination, and we wanted to remove these elements, but we could not, because there were so many repetitive sequences in the surroundings that was preventing us from achieving this aim. We could not do this deletion. And I'm telling you this, we tried for almost 20 years. Eventually we come across the CRISPR-Cas system, and by this we only need 20 nucleotides that are targeted and unique left and right to our desired regulatory element. If we do this, we can promote the removal, and this is something we did, and as you can see, we removed the regulatory element and we got animals that were born already with a phenotype, with less pigmentation. Remember that I'm not touching the coding, but the non-coding region. So this is already relevant, and this was something that was repeated in different lines, and we could align all these different deletions and we could do genetic analysis and we could pinpoint what was the sequence that was relevant for this regulatory element. So this is solving a problem that could not be solved before without the using CRISPR. With CRISPR, we can not only do one mutation at a time, but we can do many mutations at a time. We can do faster, but we can combine different guides and produce different mutations, different mouse mutants carrying 1, 2, 3, in principle, many. Actually, this is can be brought to the maximum. You can target all genes in a human cell. And this is what these Australian researchers did with this jellyfish. This is a very poison jellyfish that we don't know the antidote for this poison, for these tentacles. And they were preparing extracts of this poison, and they were given to cells in which they were targeting with CRISPR to all the genes we have in the human cell. And of course, most of the cells died because of the poison, but only few survived because they had inactivated a pathway that was using this poison for being toxic. That this is something that experiment we couldn't do before, or something we do these days, which is what we call avatar, in which we transmit to the mice the mutations that we diagnose in humans. So this, I'm using the metaphor from this science fiction movie, in which these blue characters, they were linked, each one of them, to one human person. Remember that the traditional way of mutating genes has been removing big pieces, but this is a bit gross, it's a bit rude. Whereas with CRISPR now we can do very politely, we can do this very educatedly, and we can just remove just one nucleotide, probably the one that changes this protein and turns this protein to be non-functional. And this is what we have done with a number of different mice. This is one of them. This is a person that the only mutation that she has is that she's missing one C, and exactly the same C has been transmitted to this mouse, to the corresponding gene, so we can now validate treatments before going into patients. We can validate these treatments on this corresponding avatar mice. Regarding gene therapy, which is one of the ideal solutions and aims for CRISPR, there is another value that I want to comment with you, which is skepticism. We have to remain skeptics, and we don't have to just buy all what is published simply because it's published, let's say, in a big journal like Nature. This is a Nature paper. It was published August 2017, and in human embryos, they claimed they had corrected a pathogenic gene with CRISPR, a gene that was associated with some cardiomyopathy. And they were using sperm from a donor that was heterozygous, and they were using oocytes from women that were healthy. Of course, if the donor was heterozygous, it means half of the sperm cells were wild type. And when they claim, for instance, here that 72% of these embryos were corrected, they need to acknowledge that 50% they come from the wild-type allele of the male, and the next 22% they were claiming, probably this is not true, because this is under discussion. And the reason for this is because it was later known that among the different problems we have with CRISPR is that there are some pieces that can be removed, and we can promote, after cutting, we can promote very large deletions. And by doing this, if we are investigating the correction of a given mutation by PCR, we can say maybe the woman allele is being used to correct the male allele or the man allele. And if we do a PCR, we check the presence of a given band. But I'm telling you that by just promoting the cut in the male mutant allele, we might promote very big deletions by which the gene disappears and we only able to amplify the healthy allele, which might just give us the idea that we have already corrected the mutation, whereas we have not corrected anything, we have just removed the allele, and this will require very systematic analysis with different PCRs to get around this problem. There's a number of limitations we need to know regarding CRISPR. First, the off-target effects in which we can target similar sequences. So here the two different genes, but they have a different tone of blue, but they are blue genes. Basically, we can say we can target maybe very similar sequences. There are many programs, bioinformatic programs that we can use. We have contributed with some of them and we have published in the past years. And actually, when we try to see whether this is happening in vivo, we don't find this. Off targets are not very relevant because very rarely we have these mutations in similar sequences if we provide a very defined amount of the CRISPR-Cas9 complex. And this is confirmed by the massive sequences. And this is why we have to remain skeptic when publication like this one, they say they were claiming thousands of mutations after a CRISPR-Cas experiment. Actually, this paper, as you can see here at the bottom, is retracted. So it's retracted because it wasn't true. Because these guys, they knew about their disease, but they forgot about the basic genetics. They forgot about spontaneous mutations that we are all accumulating. And of course, with the genetic drift. You can have two litter mates, two mouse, which are coming from a given inbred line that are originally identical, but if you set up a breeding program independent, each one of them, at each generation, there will be new mutations spontaneously introduced, and you will be selecting individuals, so you will be doing genetic drift. So 10 generations later, maybe you have a lot of difference, but none of these differences is related with CRISPR, is related with the fact that the mutations were accumulated. Now, if you compare one of these later mouse with the original mouse, of course you will find thousands of mutations, but none of them is related with CRISPR. So the off target is not an issue, the on target is an issue. So basically we are promoting mosaicism. There's a number of different alleles that have been organized. And this is what you can see because we're working with pigmentation and we see all this, let's say this mouse, instead of being uniform, it's patchy and it's got some parts which are pigmented and some parts which are not pigmented because the CRISPR-Cas system is operating at the different cells during the embryo development. And this is why it results in an animal that carries many different alleles. And this is what we see when we analyze this by sequencing. And this is why it obliges when we are creating these founder mice with edited alleles, we have to select the one that carries our desired allele. We hope that it will be segregated in the next generation and we can set up our colonies. This is the reason why we can do this very happily in the lab with these laboratory animals, but we cannot do it this simultaneously with clinical patients. Integrity and responsibility very rapidly. You can use human embryos even in Spain for research purposes, and this is in vitro, this is legal, it's necessary to understand the pre-implantation phase and it's wise. This is allowed because the legislation allows, but we cannot use CRISPR for therapeutic use in human embryos in countries like Spain because first it's illegal, second it's unwise, there is a number of mutations that we cannot control, and third it's probably unnecessary for most of the couples because we have the pre-implantation genetic diagnosis test, so we can diagnose the embryos before implanting and decide which one to implant. I'm saying this to integrity because, of course, we know that there are things that we should not be doing, such as germline editing. This is in yellow color here, because some countries allow, some other countries not allow. And there are some red things which is applying these techniques, not for curing, not for therapeutical purposes, but for enhancement purposes. And this is to say eugenics, something that we don't want to happen. And of course, we know that in November 2019, this Chinese researcher he decided to apply this without permission, and he got three girls whose genome is edited. And as you know, 1 year later, he ended up with his bones in prison for 3 years. He had to pay a good fine, and he was inhabilitated for life. So this is already sending you a message that you have to keep this research integrity also with this QH advanced methods. And this has been confirmed. So I'm just reaching to this one I wanted. Let me jump to the last part of the seminar, because I wanted to tell you about this. So I wanted to tell you about innovation. Innovation is another value. Innovation such as, what about if we eliminate the capacity for these nucleases to do a genome editing? And if we create a dead Cas9 that is not able to cut the DNA any longer, we can associate this with effector domains. And if we do this, we still will label a position in the genome. And if we associate with an activator domain, we can activate specifically a gene, or we can inactivate if this is a repressor unit. We can do things more elaborated, such as base editing. This is pure innovation. We can associate with a chemical activity that might change, let's say, C into a T or A into a G. And this is mostly done by the lab of David Liu from the Broad. And this is one of the best and well-known innovators in the field. The last innovation he did was this prime editing, in which he was combining a nickase. It's a nuclease, a Cas9 that is cutting only one strand, not both strands, associated with reverse transcriptase. You will see this in the next slide. Basically, it is a long guide that is targeting the complex to a given place in the genome, but also the last end of this long guide is serving as a template to reconstitute the DNA thanks to the reverse transcriptase unit. This is a genial idea. This is genius. And so far, this has been complicated to implement. But this is just to tell you that innovation should be also an associated value. So asking relevant questions, such as Matthew Porteous. Matthew Porteous was the first one to realize that we were about to use Cas9 from Streptococcus pyogenes and Staphylococcus aureus, which are bacteria that are pathogenic for us, for humans. We have been using them in mice and in cells. That were great. And then he said, what about if our immune system has already antibodies or lymphocytes against these bacteria and their compounds? And he was right, because we have antibodies against Cas9. And of course, that was kind of a very disappointment, because people were ready to use these systems for gene therapy. And all of a sudden, you realize that you can generate an allergic and hyper reaction in the patients, because the patients are already immunosensitized to these elements. Well, there are two solutions. One solution is to combine this treatment with immunosuppression drugs, and the other solution is go and isolate different CRISPR-Cas systems from other bacteria, because such as CPF1, which is now called Cas12, because we have 80% of the archaeas and 50% of the bacteria, they have CRISPR-Cas systems that are yet to be discovered and characterized. So basically, we can have other systems. And then finally, I just going very rapidly, but the last value I wanted to mention to you is looking beyond the obvious. Looking beyond the obvious, because so far, what I've been describing is so-called CRISPR 1.0, which is cutting and editing DNA, whereas the 2.0 is cutting and editing RNA, in which the DNA is left untouched, but then we are operating on the top of the RNA mutation. And this is something else. This is what Feng Zhang obtained in 2017. He characterized a nuclease called Cas13, that with a specific guide RNA was targeting the corresponding complementary RNA. But then he realized that when this was happening, this nuclease became crazy, and he was cutting all the different RNAs in the mixture. For most people, this would have been the end of the experiment. This would have been just a phenomenal fiasco. But Feng Zhang, thought that this could have some additional uses, because he thought, if I spike the mixtures with small RNA molecules that have a fluorescent marker and a quencher in at the other end, so this fluorescence is not being lighted because of the presence of the quencher, when the target of the given guide finds the RNA, the nuclease will cut everything, including this spike-probe small RNA molecules, and then you will see the light. So basically, you can convert a fiasco into a real diagnose system, and this is what is called Sherlock. And this was described in 2017, and it was also found with other nucleases called Detector by Jennifer Doudna with Cas12a. So this can be converted into a flow, lateral flow with crop actigraphy, and basically you can have one of these pieces of paper, this solid chemical in which you can diagnose, such as a pregnancy test, you can diagnose for the presence of virus. And this is something that has been used already for COVID. So Sherlock has been already applied at the beginning of the year in March. And so you can detect up to 10 copies of the virus just using this lateral flow. And this has been, you can really multiply this, combining this with microfluidics in nanodroplets, in which you can do very specific Sherlock experiments in thousands of these droplets. Basically, you can diagnose thousands of people at a time. And you can also apply other types of detecting with CRISPR. This is the detector. This is no longer Cas12. It's Cas13. It's Cas12. Cas12 also cuts single strand molecules, not RNA but DNA. And this is what has been published in May in this year. And this is another alternative system for detecting viruses versus the traditional gold standard RT-PCR. It's faster, it's simple, it's less sensitive. It's qualitative. It tells you whether the virus is present or not. It's not quantitative. Well, we have to know that RT-PCR is quantitative, but so far we are not using this data because we're telling only the patients whether they are infected or not. So basically, for the same reason, we can do this with CRISPR. With the RT-PCR, in principle, you can go down to one copy per microliter, and with the CRISPR-related method, you can go down to 10 copies per microliter. For most of the applications, it will be fine. The last innovation was in May, also regarding Sherlock, and that's very easy because it only requires a thermoblock and some pipettes and some tubes and these strips for reading the results. And this is something that can be done in any place. So you don't require any sophisticated. This has been already approved in the States, not in Europe, unfortunately. So we still have to use RT-PCR or the antigen detecting test. But in States, since 8th of May, you can apply CRISPR for detected. And this is already generating a lot of good and benefits. So let me jump to the end by just saying that was a very quick that we started at the Cell Works of Santa Pola, and I told you a number of different values, and these are the list of the values that I illustrated. And I just want to finish by saying that besides all these values, you have to enjoy science because it's fun too. So this is the other people in my lab. And I recommend you, if you're interested, I keep a website on CRISPR in which you can sort of just go to Google, type in CNB, which is where I work, and CRISPR, and you will get a lot of information and presentations and papers from the historical part of CRISPR. And with this, I think I will finish and thank you, and apologizing once again for this video conference issues. But you know, this is what we have to do these days. At least we could solve this through YouTube, and I hope you could follow this this seminar. Thank you. ¿Qué tal, Félix? ¿Se ha oído bien o qué? Sí. Sí, hola. Ah. Ah, sí. Ah, perfecto. Ah, muy bien. Venga.